Hi, I'm Mike Cahill, and I'll be talking about stakeholders in language development, opportunities, and challenges. Gone are the days when an outside linguist would unilaterally enter a minority language community, decide what needed to be done to develop the language, and direct the whole process himself. And it was usually himself. But the last few decades have actually seen a marked increase in two things. First, multilingualism among the world's minority language speakers. And second, an increased educational level and corresponding awareness of the outside world and its methodologies. See the references. Local communities are taking an increasing role in both initiating and participating in developing their own languages, often beginning with orthography and basic literacy. There is still a role for the outsider, but it is often as informed advisor rather than lead mover. For such outside advisors, as well as local activists, it's helpful to have a realistic view of who has an interest in the language for whatever reason. These are the stakeholders. These stakeholders can be very helpful or resistant to the point of obstructing the entire project. In this presentation, I discuss a variety of stakeholders, their positive contributions, as well as challenges in working with them. The main context will be orthography development, since that is what I know best, but most of this talk is also relevant to other types of language documentation and development. Let's talk first about stakeholders who are members of the local community. Just like building a house is easier when lots of people help, working with the local speakers in a community can have some real advantages. Getting involved with the local community means they will take ownership of the orthography. The responsibility is spread around and the workload is lighter for all too. But maybe the most important benefit is acceptance of the orthography. If the community is involved from the very start and they're making the decisions, they will have a realistic sense of ownership. So this writing system is not something that is imposed on them. It's not created by someone who may not even be a mainstream member of the community. It is their achievement, and so it is much more likely to be accepted and thus actually used. There are some challenges, of course. Working with the whole community takes more time than just one person working by himself. Often different community members have different opinions. Disagreements happen, and all these need to be negotiated and sorted out. It also takes deliberate effort so that all parts of the community are represented, dialects, clans, etc. So let's look at a few types of people in the community in more detail. First, let's talk about community leaders. These could be chiefs, elders, leaders of local religions, or others who might have a position of power, either a formal position or just a very respected local person. What is the local authority structure? It's worth finding out. In many societies, the first people to come to mind would be men, but don't forget the women leaders. In our time in a village in northern Ghana, we found out that there was an official position of men's work leader and of women's work leader. We didn't even know there was an office of women's work leader when we started, but they turned out to be crucial. Leaders have an awareness of the needs of their language community, and usually they want what's best for the community. In many cases, leaders are responsible for the well-being of their community, and they take this responsibility quite seriously. Second, these leaders are the ones who can make things happen. They know their people, and whoever has the skills and character to be helpful in a language committee, for example. In some cases, they might even be able to help financially with the project, though you shouldn't count on that. Also, local leaders can be influential in adopting the orthography or in promoting the orthography itself when it's completed. In some situations, they may actually be the ones to approve or disapprove of the entire project. So if you ignore them, you are not only neglecting a potential source of help, but some leaders may actually end up opposing the work because they were not asked to be involved. Of course, there are some challenges with local leaders too. Many times they are very busy, so they may not be able to devote much time to a project. Some of them may travel a lot. One way many of them deal with this is they choose someone to represent them, and that may be the main person you deal with. And there are other challenges of working with or coordinating with local leaders. For one thing, they may start out not being fully convinced about the benefits of the orthography or literacy in general if their society has not historically had literacy as part of their lifestyle and traditions. So it's important to spend some time with them to lay out the ideas and ask for whatever help they might be able to give. Sometimes local leaders may have some different ideas about what kind of orthography may work for a community. So there's a challenge to arrive at a compromise or decision, but interacting with the local leaders is time well spent. Now, let's talk about the so-called ordinary language speaker, the local language speaker, who is not in a position of official leadership, but still can be a tremendous help. Sometimes these could be educated speakers, sometimes just a typical speaker who wants to help out. Often these might be part of a language committee. The people we're talking about here are people who will provide the main ideas and help in establishing the orthography. Mainly, and most obviously, this ordinary language speaker brings their native speaker insight into the language being studied for orthography development. They may know linguistics terms or they may not, but they can often distinguish sounds outsiders can't hear easily. They also bring an insider's perspective about the community. What other stakeholders should be involved? Perhaps when speakers of a different dialect or clan need to be brought in, or maybe other community members that the outsider hasn't even thought about. These other individuals might affect how the orthography is accepted. Also, they can have ideas on logistics and how to promote the orthography. Generally, local speakers are motivated for the project and they're aware of the value of developing the orthography, and they can spread that enthusiasm to others. So far, we focused on the local community, local language speakers, community leaders, and the community at large. Now, let's switch to stakeholders who are not native local language speakers, linguist researchers, national and local governments, and local teachers and religious leaders. Let's talk first about the linguist researcher. I'll say linguist for short. This is someone who investigates the language, finding out how it works, what the consonants and vowels and tones are, and this knowledge feeds into the orthography. 20 years ago, this linguist would almost always have been a foreigner and not a native speaker of the language. But today, there are three types of linguists. There's the linguist who is a native speaker of the language. There's a linguist who comes from another country altogether, a foreigner. And there's also the linguist who is from elsewhere within the country, and maybe even a native speaker of a different minority language. So let's keep all of these types of linguists in mind. What does a linguist, either a local speaker or one of the outside types, bring to the task of orthography development? The obvious main answer for all of these is linguistic knowledge and background. Their training gives them knowledge about how languages work. It also gives them a methodology, how to investigate a language. An outside linguist, either a foreigner or someone from a different part of the country, brings an outsider's perspective. First, she can see more of the whole picture, not just a small local bit. An outside linguist can have an objective view of the language being studied. Second, as an outsider, the linguist could be a neutral person for helping settle differences of opinion. Yes, there will be differences of opinion. Finally, an outside person can connect with resources outside the community that would help the project. Maybe finances, computer tools, organizational methods, or even an entire outside research community. But Outside linguists can experience challenges that are unique to their outsider status. Connection with outside resources can help, as we mentioned, but it can create pressure to rush through a project faster than is ideal. Also, an outsider can be ignorant about the needs of the community, especially of cultural values that might influence orthography development. Finally, outside linguists may not be able to speak the local language well. It's unusual if they can, actually. So it's a bigger challenge for them to connect directly with local people. Now, a native speaker linguist would not have that particular challenge since they can speak the language. As a member of the community himself, he would be able to automatically avoid at least some cultural traps. He also has a huge advantage in being a native speaker himself, so he can talk to people in their own language. However, as a native of the community, he will also have some community responsibilities that an outsider does not have. This can help with the acceptability of the orthography, but it is a challenge because it can take time away from the other tasks of orthography development. A totally different type of stakeholder that sometimes academics overlook is governments, both local and national. They can be very interested or not interested at all. Most of the time we're talking about a national government because that is where policy decisions are made. However, local government officials have responsibility for what goes on in their domain, so they often want to be at least kept informed as to what's going on. Some governments have a very keen interest in orthography for other unwritten languages, but others don't get involved at all. In some cases, any new orthography must be approved by a government agency. Other countries may have a list of specific symbols you can use and you can't add to these. Government policies can change, so it's good to know what the current policies are, not what someone told you 10 years ago. Sometimes there are positive sides to government policies. In an unusually good case, a government may actually provide resources, even funding, to help in orthography development and the literacy that will follow. Another benefit the governments could offer would be formal recognition of an orthography on the local or national level. This could take the shape of official permission to use the orthography at local schools, for example. Sometimes there are challenges in working with governments as stakeholders. If orthography guidelines are overly strict, this may hamper the development of the orthography. But there may sometimes be a bright side to such strict guidelines. For example, if you're trying to decide on one symbol versus another one, government policy may have already decided it. And this means you do not have to spend time and energy arguing about it. But government policies may not always be helpful. As an example, if the list of allowed symbols does not include one to represent a particular phoneme of the language, then that is a problem. It may be possible to appeal to the government, but in some cases, you may just have to settle for a less than ideal orthography. The last kind of stakeholders we want to talk about is teachers and religious leaders from the outside who are now living in the community. These would be pastors, priests, imams, and others. Like the other stakeholders, there is great potential for positive impact and potential for challenges too. For one thing, religious leaders and teachers can be great advocates in the community for learning to read and write at all. This is because they are usually educated and they see the value of reading. Also, they can help with testing orthographies. Both teachers and religious leaders have people they lead, and their congregations or students, their followers, are natural subjects for testing the orthography. These teachers and religious leaders can be really helpful, but as with other stakeholders, there are challenges to keep in mind. Both teachers and religious leaders may not value the local language much. Teachers may be focused so much on teaching the national language that they see the local language as a barrier to learning and to advancement. They may not see writing the local language as a positive thing for the community. Likewise, if a particular religion is expressed in one particular language or a particular script, some of the religious leaders may want to focus on reading in that language or that script and not the local one. If that is the case, it may be helpful to discuss one particular point with them. This is that reading is only learned once. The skills of reading, knowing that a letter stands for a sound, that you start at the top of a page, and so forth, these are skills you only learn once. It is much easier to learn these skills if you're doing it in your own language. And so, learning to read in your own language will actually be a good bridge toward learning to read in another language. I hope that this talk on stakeholders has given you a better understanding of why it's really important to think first about who the stakeholders are in your situation, and secondly, why it's important to interact with all of them. Some of my points may strike you as overly optimistic, and others may strike you as overly pessimistic. I think an overall reasonable strategy for relating to stakeholders is to assume goodwill at the outset, but be aware of the potential pitfalls too, so they don't catch you by surprise. I have not discussed all the possible stakeholders for orthography. Here's a few others I'll mention just briefly. One, developers of previous orthographies, especially if they're well-loved by the local community. Two, local language committees or other local organizations, what is already in place? Three, local people who have already been writing or at least attempting to write in the local language, what have they done? And four, any financial sponsors and partnerships who are already connected to the community. In terms of orthography, these stakeholders can make a huge difference in the usability of an orthography, which asks, can people actually use it? Stakeholders also really help in determining the acceptability of an orthography, which asks, will people actually want to use the orthography? Because of this, it's worth investing in these relationships and getting to know your stakeholders. Encouraging them to all work together harmoniously is sometimes a challenge beyond the scope of this talk. We need to keep in mind that developing an orthography is not only a technical matter, but it involves real people with real needs and real dreams. But it is important to recognize all of these stakeholders, those who will actively work on a project, as well as those who merely ask to be kept informed, and to balance their contributions seriously. Thank you.